So I've rubbed out my spindle stock, and this is what it looks like. And there's actually 11 of these for the chair, because the chair I'm going to build has a tail on it. I think earlier I might have said there were 9, but there's 11 of the long ones, and then there's 4 of the short ones. And I don't turn the short spindles. I think a lot of people turn the short spindles, and 6 1 half dozen another, but I like to whittle mine. So this shaving horse, if you don't know what this is a Swiss style horse. And let's look at some draw knives first. So there's a bevel up and a bevel down draw knife. That means some knives you use with the bevel down, some knives you use with the bevel up. And, or at least I do. And the way that I tell the difference is, if you have a knife and the back of the knife is in line with the tangs on the handle, then it's more comfortable to use it bevel down. If you put out your hands with it, you'll see that if the bevel's down, it rests real nice on the work. Whereas if you flip it over and try to use it bevel up, which you can, you just have to cock your wrist a little bit right there. So it doesn't mean that you can't do it, it's just that it's not as comfortable. And here's a knife where the back is canted to the handles. And same thing on the opposite. If you try to use it with the bevel up, it just lays really nice and flat. But if you turn it over with the bevel down, you've got to move your wrist in an uncomfortable position to be able to use it. And I have both. I have lots of them. I probably have 20 draw knives. And I use them for different purposes. The bevel up knife is really good for long straight pulls. Bevel down knife is good for any type of dips or curves, but they're interchangeable too. Now the knife that I'm going to rough out this spindle stock with is a rather large knife. It's a Barton. Barton's one of my favorites. And it's a bevel up knife, although it has this huge bevel on the back that acts as really the back, the flat back. And so I'm going to use it, and I'm going to take this and whittle. Now if you look straight down that, you'll see that it's slightly curved. And that is the way the long wood fibers run. And the key to this whole process is following those long wood fibers. If your draw knife sharp enough, it'll tell you where they are. You can lay the knife right in there and just peel right with them. So the spindle will end up slightly curved, but it will, one, be stronger, but more importantly is the workability. I'll be able to shave this spindle, either with the draw knife or with the spoke shave, knowing that it's going to cut in the direction that I'm pulling every single time. So I don't have to turn it around and push or anything like that. So I'm going to start in the radial plane first, because it's just a little bit easier to cut in, and lay the draw knife right down and pull and let the draw knife find those long wood fibers. And right there it is. I'll flip it over, and I'll let the draw knife kind of drag on that flat area till it hits an area where material needs to be taken off. And you hear that little bit of splitting? It means that there's material that's stacked up there that needs to be taken off in order to get straight wood fibers. And there it is. And your cut ought to be nice and clean by that time. So that's one side that's good, and that's the radial plane. You can see the medullary rays right here. Flip it over to the tangential plane. And this one, we've got it kind of color-coded, so we've got some help there. If you look at it, you can see there's a ring, there's a ring, there's a ring right there. This is the layer that everything needs to be in all the way out. So I can flip it like this and get right underneath that layer and pull it. There we go. I can follow one color all the way out. Okay. Now those are the two most important cuts on the spindle, because they're going to establish what's going to happen from here on out, whether you're going to have problems with it or not. Now you can take your combination square and mark the thickness that you want. I use a just a cheap old marking gauge, and my bulb diameter is 3/4. That's the largest diameter on the spindle. That's what I'm going to set it to. And now, going after the radial plane again, I can just cut it right down to that line. And go to the tangential plane. I can lay the draw knife right in that score line. And there we go. So now I have a 3/4 inch square to start with. And as you can see, I maintained the curve. But if you look at those growth rings, you see that they're dead on all the way down. Okay? And it's the same way in this plane, although you can't see it as well. Now I need to lay out where the bulb is. And on this chair, where's my pencil? Bottom of the bulb's at 3.5, and the top is at 8. So now I'll go to one of my smaller knives here, and I'm going to shape the lower tenon, the tenon that goes into the seat. So I'm looking for something about 5/8 right there. Now I got the long taper. Came out of the cut there. Gotta go back in and take that down. So there we go. Got 3/8 heavy there because I want to end up at 3/8. So now I have a square version of the spindle. And now I take it into an octagonal. And the closer I can get to an octagonal, the more uniform and round my spindle is going to be when I get ready to round it with spoke shave. There we go. Got an octagonal version of the spindle. So I'm going to put it in the, well, I'm going to let it air dry a little bit first. I wouldn't want to stick something this green into the kiln. But I let it sit around the shop for a week or so. Then I'll put it in the dry kiln and I'll dry it. When I take it out, at that time, everything will have shrunk and I'll be able to size the tenons, the two tenons, and then round it with the spoke shave. So that'd be the next thing I do.